Italy and Germany, right?
Yes.
Like roughly. So, I mean, sorry guys, though India has this kind of tradition of boasting of a history that goes back 20,000 years, you're in that one patch of of India which doesn't have history. How do you do history? You do history because there's material stuff, right? People write down stuff and leave it behind. You have archives, you have temples, you have monuments, you have things that remain. And from the things that remain, you judge what happens. Delhi, for instance, the capital city of India, likes to think of itself as the city before time. It was not just a city that has a historical beginning. It is a city that has a mythical origin. It starts when India's seminal traditions, the tradition of the Mahabharata, the great epic in which good fights evil in a mammoth struggle for the soul of mankind. When that war is waged, Delhi is already a city. Banaras, a religious city that is supposed to have been alive at the time that Shiva was born. It is not just the place where, say, a pope lives. It's not just the place where a god was born. It is the god himself. He sits by the banks, by the west banks, and looks across at the rising sun. And when the sun rises in the east and wakes the eyes of Lord Shiva, if you die on the eastern banks, you will come back as a donkey. If you die on the western banks on Shiva's side, you will be reborn into eternal bliss. This is the difference between the west bank and the east bank. For more details, Diana L. Eck, The City of Light. Diana L. Eck wrote a beautiful book about the sacred geography of Banaras. Who's written a great book about Bombay? Not yet. The book of history, the book of Bombay's history, the book that will talk about Bombay's geography, the book that will talk about its sacred landscape, its memories, its seven islands scattered, small, volcanic, across a marshland of swamp water coming in and going out, hundreds of years undisturbed, only fisher folk, the Kolis who dance and who hang onto the city. When trawlers erode their livelihood and take away everything that is left of these fisher people. A tiny bunch of people lives in these seven islands that Ptolemy noted as Heptanesia in his maps. No one cared. No one cared about Bombay. It had no strategic importance. In the 3rd century BC, Ashoka has walked through a battlefield of such Pyrrhic devastation that he decides that war is no longer a possibility. One of the greatest of conversions to non-violence happens at a moment when violence is transcendent. Ashoka has won a battle and decides that he will never fight again. There is no way he can win a war because wars are not to be won. The Buddha enters his soul, he becomes a Buddhist, India starts to become Buddhist, and not content with that kind of conversion, Ashoka sends his daughter off to Sri Lanka to make Sri Lanka Buddhist. Sanghamitra, Shongamitra, or the friend of the Buddhist order of monks, her name is, she comes to leave from Sri Lanka, not very far from here, from what is called Nalla Sopara. Now it's a 30-second stop on the way to Bombay. It's a small little train station there. There is a small stupa where there are a few relics of the Buddha supposed to be inside. Locals raid it for the bricks and take away the bricks to build. No one knows where this is because the sea, which always plays a part in Bombay's history, and the rivers, which also play a part in Bombay's history, repeatedly intervening at times when no one can expect interventions, the sea grabs Nalla Sopara, fills the river, and makes the port impassable. Nalla Sopara, which is once this huge, brilliant, you know, sort of bustling port, which lots of ships coming, going, trade in spices and slaves and silk and what have you, dies. It's dead. And Bombay settles back into quietness. takes 900 years, which is, you know, in Indian time, it is a blink in the eyelash of Shiva's modern snooze style. But 900 years, there is no recorded history. There's nothing. How did those 900 years pass? What changes were sweeping the globe? Nothing touches Bombay. Malaria, fishing, swamps, mangroves, panthers in the hills, lions coming down till 1950. Jackals wandered in Chembur. And it was possible for one of the greatest of India's ornithologists, Salim Ali, to go shooting. And he started his career as an amateur marksman, to go shooting not very far from where we are sitting. Okay? So the notion of city and of countryside, of jungle and of built-up landscape is not complete in India. Till today, one of the causes of deaths in India is panther death. A five-year-old boy last year was picked, or 2 years ago, was picked out of his very suave and fancy building house by a panther that left the wall from the Sanjay Gandhi National Park and picked up the boy and left back with him and killed him and ate him because he only little bits for his recovery, enough to bury him. So therefore, after that, we decided that one way to deal with this would be to put a dog there so that the panther would come and get the dog instead. And of course, the dog lovers of Bombay protested angrily, and so an intermediate animal was found, an intermediate animal being a goat. Goats are okay, but dogs are not. Human beings die of panther bite in, you know, major metropolises every single day. Last year, I was looking at records, and 3 people died of cobra bite in this city. So it's a nice and pleasant city. Welcome. I hope you brought your anti-venom kits with you. Okay. The next moment that Bombay intervenes in history is suddenly there is this Chalukyan king. The Chalukyans are a dynasty that are from up north somewhere. He decides to come to Bombay and decides to build a temple. He's a nice guy. He wants to build a temple. This is what you do. In those days, I mean, charity is not sort of written into Indian religions in a big way. Except Islam and Christianity come and bring the notion of charity, of being nice to other people. Because if I'm nice to you, and it's not my dharma to be nice, I might actually be doing the wrong thing. So I might as well not be nice. Yeah? So in general, there's no system of building hospitals or orphanages or schools or stuff like that. You don't do that stuff. And then they build a temple, yeah? And the temple gets you goodwill from the gods, and you know, once the gods are happy, what's it matter if people are dying there? So this Chalukyan king comes in the sense to try and build a temple. Only the problem is that the whole of the Deccan Plateau, and the Deccan Plateau is the youngest part of India, being volcanic rock, okay? The Deccan Plateau is made of a very bizarre stone called amygdaloidal trap. Now, why is it called amygdaloidal trap? Who knows? Amygdaloidal trap, however, has a problem. When you build a temple, in India, what you do when you build temples is you put up your columns. And I'm telling architects how to build temples. Yay. I like that. You put up your columns and you put your plinths on top of your columns and then you put your gopuram on top. That's how you build a temple. The gopuram is kind of like arching structure on the top and leaves that plinth and cover. Now, when the amygdaloidal trap is cut into plinths, it breaks. It just does not want to be cut that way. You can build columns all the time, but you can't build plinths. So what happens is that every time you sort of cut a nice big hard chunk of black rock, which looks like nothing could break it. You can't even your columns working fine, you got the plinth in bits. So, net result, Indian ingenious thinking. What do? You find a piece of rock that looks like a temple is hidden inside it, like Michelangelo saw statues inside, blocks of Carrara marble, etc., etc. You find a nice big chunk of stone that looks like a temple is hidden inside it, and since you are building on an epic scale, you are building with the backing of huge kings, dynasties, emperors, traders of billions and billions and billions of whatever passes for currency at that time. You choose hills. You take a hill. and you divide the hill into temple and not temple, and you cut out not temple. What is left behind is a temple. Ellora, for instance, a day's journey away from here by train and 2 hours' journey by flight will give you a clue into the Indian aesthetic that gives us Bollywood today. They'll give you a clue into why Indian men wear red shirts. Yeah? They'll give you a clue into how we look at notions of beauty. There are two aesthetics side by side. Buddhist, the Buddhist aesthetic, in which the great painted murals of Ajanta, and next door to it is the Hindu carvings and sculptures of Ellora. Not far from here, however, the Chalukyan king who built his temple at Bharapuri, out in the bay in Bombay, carved a beautiful series of sculptures in the Shaivite tradition, which means the Lord of Destruction, Shiva. Okay. Which has been described as a dialectic between the Shaivite and the Hindu tradition. It's a four-hour journey out into the sea from where you are sitting. Right? Sixth century moment then ceases. Nothing happens again. For another 400 years, there's complete silence. The Chalukyas own Bombay, but they don't care. They're not really bothered about it. And then come the Silharas, another bunch of people. The Silharas leave no trace of their presence. Again, if you were to leave here and walk down this road, and then turn to your left along the sea, to your right along the sea, and walk up the hill towards the governor's bungalow, you will come to a small freshwater tank, which is bang next to the sea. Now, freshwater tank that is lying next to the sea is always, always in India a sign of the god. Because it is a miracle. You have salt water, you have fresh water. Of course, there are geological explanations. There's a spring, a subterranean spring that feeds it, etc., etc. But how much more exciting to say that in the wandering of a thirsty god and goddess, the goddess is thirsty. And she says to the god, feed me, give me water. And so the god, knowing that the only way to quench a woman's thirst, especially a goddess's thirst, is to draw the holy mother Ganga from the north of India right down to the south, shoots an arrow into the ground, into the rocky soil, and what springs forth is Ban Ganga. The Ban of the arrow brings the Ganga forth. And therefore, if you should need your sins forgiven, circumambulate the tank 6 times in the clockwise direction, and that will be that. You will be forgiven your sins up to now. You can come back for refreshers in the next few years after other sins have been committed. Please note that killing a cow ranks as much higher a sin than killing a human. So eating beef will probably mean that you have to come back on a fairly regular basis to have your sins taken away from you. Right. Now, from the time that we have this temple being built, which by the way was built in the 11th century and was erased in the 17th century by our friends the Portuguese. White man ahoy! The Portuguese have arrived! History begins! Nationalism begins! Europe reaches India! It's a very familiar story for almost, half the places in the world where white people travel, they have to undergo guilt, and now the other half they have to undergo mourning. Because it's all the same, it's like, some white person came and did some terrible stuff. So what did the Portuguese do? Minor stuff. First they went to Bharapuri, where the chap had built his 6th century temple. And when they were coming up in their boat, they saw an elephant waiting for them they thought, wow. And they named the island Elephanta Island. When they arrived, they found that the elephant was carved out of rock. Okay? So then, good European imperative. You like something, it's there, you take it home. So, you break the 4 legs, you pick up the elephant. But they're Portuguese. They don't know much about engineering. They haven't figured out the load ratio and the weight of the buoyancy of tons of solid rock. Remember, this is an amygdaloidal tract. The elephant is not hollow. The elephant doesn't have a stick up its bum like, you know, Michelangelo's boss. It is actually everything that is not elephant has been cut away and elephant has been left behind. So as soon as elephant is lifted onto boat sinks, and elephant stays at the bottom of the water for 200 years. Meanwhile, the Portuguese go on to do other things. They build three forts which are left behind, which are still visible in Bombay, and Rahul, I'm sure, will be able to point them out to you as you're traveling. There's one fort which is the Mahim fort, one fort which is the Bandra fort, and one fort which is the Sion fort. Mahim, Sion, Bandra, and I'm writing down. There are 300-year-old forts. In any other civilization which cares about its history, 300-year-old forts would be filled with, you know, museums and galleries and art shops and little CD-ROM displays, etc., etc. The Mahim fort has a timber mart inside it. The Sion fort is used as a public toilet, and the Bandra fort is completely being eroded by the water even as we speak. Slash, slash, slash. But from the Sion fort, another bizarre little Bombay miracle is visible. Every year, 20,000 flamingos come in from who knows where and come and land in the dirtiest, filthiest, most polluted bay on the west coast. And you know, they didn't stand flamingos at. They could choose where they wanted to go. But no, they come to Bombay, to the Shirdi Bay, which is filled with industrial pollutants, and they eat themselves sick. And then they go off to make in the run of touch, which is uptown. But right now, 20,000 flamingos are actually like, flamingos can't smell, see, they have very bad smell. So Bombay is a great place if you can't smell, right? It becomes a very pleasant experience. And the flamingo's eye is bigger than its brain, which means that it has very little brain. So it will eat polluted stuff and it can go and eat fresh water, you know, stuff all the way down the coast. Anyway, now those are the three forts that are built, and in 1600 and so and so, so and so, King Charles II is given a dowry. He doesn't want to marry the Portuguese infanta. He so doesn't. He should just be having a good time, King Charles II. But, you know, they sweeten the pot in those days, so they throw in a dowry, and Bombay is given to King Charles II. King Charles thinks it's in Brazil. He being very geographically sound. Yeah, yeah, let's go to Brazil. Let's get some pills. He thinks he doesn't know this coming to Bombay. He gets Bombay. He does nothing with it because he can't figure out what to do. And into Bombay's history strides the enigmatic and mysterious figure of Sir Gerald Angier. Sir Gerald Angier arrives, and like most other people, instead of just slapping the mosquitoes and going off somewhere happening like Surat or Delhi, he notices that there is a great harbour. If you were to climb onto the terrace of this building, you can see the dinosaurs of the cranes in the harbour. 500 metres away from you in that direction is Bombay's big, huge harbour. He realizes the national harbour. There's a source of water. You know, this is where shipping from the coast can come in and wait. And so he goes up to the crown and he says, what do you want for Bombay? The crown, King Charles II being vastly, vastly given great forethought, says £10 a year. So for £10 a year, Bombay is handed over to the East India Company, which begins its operations here, because Surat, which is a port in Gujarat, is beginning again to silt over. And Surat silting over also means that a very important thing happens for Bombay's history. The Gujaratis begin to arrive. The Gujaratis are a community of traders, largely of traders from a western state. They begin to arrive in Bombay and they begin to trade in cotton. And Bombay starts, you know, sort of slowly pulling, inching its way along to being a big city. Not really, you know, nobody wants to go to Bombay. Goa, for that matter, is huge. Goa is something that the British really want from the Portuguese. The Portuguese refused to give it to them in the dowry. Goa is actually, at that time, not a holiday destination. Goa is business. Bombay is, well, it could be Goa if you tried, right? And then the American Civil War breaks out. as soon as the American Civil War breaks out, cotton, which is being supplied in huge quantities by the slave labor of the southern plantations, suddenly stops coming to British mills. The British mills are empty. They don't know how to function. So, as a result, they need someone, somebody to give them cotton. And that somebody, Bombay. Now, what do you need for cotton? For cotton, you need black soil. Remember the amygdaloidal trap? Amygdaloidal trap is volcanic soil, volcanic, when you take a wing and rub it against a volcanic soil plateau, for millions of years you get black soil. You need water, there is water. You need humidity in the air, because otherwise the cotton breaks, it snaps if it's too dry. Okay, there's humidity in blend in Bombay. Cotton mills start to be built. But cotton mills start leaping in, the government is encouraging them, you know, saying, please guys, set up a cotton mill, how nice it would be, how lovely it would be to set up a cotton mill, take all this land for free, take all this land for 99 years, take all this land for 199 years, do what you want with it, set up a mill, right? The beginning of another myth is born, another little myth is born in the mills. Because the mills are huge walls. They need land. They need labor. And they don't care. For the first time in India, for the first time in India's history, they don't care where you were born. They don't care how you were born. They don't care what religion you follow. They don't care what caste you belong to. You have a pair of working hands. Come in here and get to work on these machines. The myth of cosmopolitanism is born in the mills of Bombay. I always say a city is an invention, a construction for inventing identity and for destroying its identities. You come to the city from, say, a little town somewhere because you don't want to be a little town girl or a little town boy. You want to be a big city dweller, you want to be a world player, you want to take your part in the pageant of history. You don't want to be some grower of olives. You want to be the guy who takes olives to North America and teaches them to eat olives. That's what you want to be. At the same time, the city envelops you, grabs you, and all those millions of dreams that are being fed into the city every day grabs you and swallows you up, eats you up. It also eats up locals. And this produces another set of tensions which today is probably the most dangerous set of tensions for the city of Bombay and its myths of cosmopolitanism. The rot began in the 1970s. We had a ruling party called the Congress. You know, the person in charge of our destinies is Italian, as you know. Sonia Maino, who was born in Italy, went to Cambridge, met this really sweet, gentle Indian boy who could barely pass his exams. His name was Rajiv Gandhi. Fell in love with him, came back home, married him, and settled into the life of being an airplane pilot's wife, except that she was an airplane pilot. I mean, the airplane pilot was the son of the Prime Minister. So he was a very special airplane pilot, we should say. Anyway, so she settled down peaceably, and then in 1982, Indira Gandhi, that was the Prime Minister, gets assassinated. Why did she get assassinated? Because Indira Gandhi is a bit of a bizarre lady. You know, as far as like very tough mother Prime Ministers go, big macho Prime Ministers go, Indira Gandhi is by far out there, beyond anybody. She's the most masculine Prime Minister we've ever had. She fights wars, she causes trouble, she rips into democracy, she announces, she becomes a little dictator, she does everything, she does whatever she wants. Right? She's male libido unchained, suddenly. Okay? And what she does, one of the things, two things she does that backfire on her. Bombay is hugely Marxist. It's run by the unions. The unions are powerful. They vote in blocks. They on election day, you knew it was election day because you get up to the sound of revolutionary songs. You know, the sound of Hum Honge Kamyaab Ek Din. We will overcome, we will overcome. Down the road, thousands and thousands of mill workers going to exercise their talent. Telling you, do what you want. want with the city. We ruled. Now, the problem was they voted Marxist. Indira Gandhi wanted them to vote Congress. So she thought a good way to do this would be to break them from within. And she funded a young cartoonist and political commentator called Bai Thackeray to try and break the unions. Of course he broke the unions. He went into the unions and played the oldest card in the book. He said, we are Maharashtrians. We live in this state. We don't get any benefits. Everyone else comes in, they get rich. We are poor. To be told you are poor, even if you are rich, is very sexy. It's hot. Because what you feel then is you feel, yes, yes, yes. This is the reason why I have not fulfilled that dream that brought me to the city. It's not me. It's not something I did. It's something they did. They! Out you go and stone them. First was the South Indians, then was the Muslims. The Shiv Sena, which Bai Thackeray founded, became such a powerful force in city politics that it kept Indira Gandhi out of city politics. She tried the same trick in Punjab. Now the Punjabis have a very bizarre history. They are Hindus, but they are not Hindus. Everybody is and is not, simultaneously. It's entirely possible, you will discover. Okay? Their holy book is one of the few syncretic holy books in the world. The Granth, which is the last of the gurus, it will be the only guru, said Nanak. The Granth contains Islamic songs and Hindu songs in equal measure. It is not written in Devanagari. Our script is called Devanagari, the script that you see on public posters, the House of the Gods. So, there's one argument for English in India which says it's the only secular language. Because otherwise, as soon as you write a letter in Hindi or Marathi or any of the Sanskrit-based languages, you invoke the God. I'm an atheist. I don't want to invoke gods. I do not wish to talk to gods. I don't write in that language. This is what Dalit India is saying. Outcast India is now saying, English may be the way out of the hegemony of Hinduism on our souls. It's a bizarre notion, but it's a notion that can live in a is-not-is state like ours. Right. Are you with me so far?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. Right. At this point in time, we have a myth. This myth is we are cosmopolitan. Our only God, we say repeatedly, is the God of money. We are founding, I mean, there is one god, temple which is huge in Bombay, which is called Mahalakshmi. Mahalakshmi is the goddess of wealth. Streams of gold coins fall from her house, her hangout hell. Diwali, the festival of lights, is a festival devoted to Lakshmi. It is incumbent on you to win some money or lose some money by gambling that night. So you gamble that night, did you? Lose some, win some, because the god is in the money and it comes to you, which is why Indian street money, if money falls on the floor, they will take it, pick it up and kiss it and then put it away or touch it to their hearts. Just as much as if my book falls on the floor, I pick it up and touch it to my heart, because the book is an incarnation of the goddess of wisdom, Saraswati. So our goddesses live in our stuff. They live in the materiality of our existence. My sweat is today for me, because I earn money out of this sweat. So I touch the sweat to my heart as well, and my forehead and say that. In 1992, a mosque falls in North India in a small town called Ayodhya. We don't know that it's this town. We wouldn't be able to find it on a map. In Bombay wouldn't. Bombay is the New York of India. It's a geographical mistake that we happen to be here. We don't belong to this messy subcontinent of passionate outpourings about caste and creed and community. We live another life. We look to the West. We speak English. We try our best to speak English even if we don't speak English. Our boys will walk up to young women on the street and say, marry me, take me home. Yeah, very commonly. Marry me, take me home. It's a nice exchange of roles. Suddenly the woman is the provider. You know, I love the moment when I was shopping with an American friend in Bombay, and this young man came and said, I look good. So American girl says, yes, yes, very good. He said, can you take me home? So the American girl said, I'm not having this conversation, which he did not understand at all. But anyway, you know, the idea is, we are not India. We just, you know, look at this building. Does it look like India? I mean, there's a people in the outside of magnificent proportions. But this is a colonial building. When Bombay talks about its architecture to its two friends that are coming, they never mention indigenous architecture. They never talk of the chars. They never talk of the bungalows. They never talk about anything indigenous. They talk about the Western buildings. They talk about the buildings Queen Victoria built after 1857 as a proclamation after the mutiny. She sent out a letter to all her viceroys, right, and told them build so that they will know we are here. Build so that they will know that we are not going anywhere. It's architecture's as political statement. Come on, everybody's heard of that, right? But this was architecture's political statement established in paper. And unfortunately for Victoria, the man who's in charge is Lord Curzon. My name is George Nathaniel Curzon. I am a most superior person. Curzon is a Brit, but he says something very, very bizarre for a Britisher, for a European of that time. He says, if we do not understand their culture or their aesthetics, it is no reason to assume that they are inferior to us. 10 years before this, 10 years before this, the British have decided that they will sell the Taj Mahal by public auction in bits and pieces. You want that window? How much are you giving for that window? So they think it's a good thing to like run a pilot project. So they get the Agra Fort and they try to sell it. But no one wants to buy the Agra Fort. They thought the Americans would buy it. Americans were buying up old ruined alleys and setting them up for a little bit of history in their country. So they thought, you know, Taj Mahal, let's move it. But no one, Lord Curzon actually funds the restoration of the Taj Mahal. He cleans it up. He does the garden again. He actually presents them with a beautiful lamp which still hangs above the tomb. He starts the Archaeological Society of India. But with one hand he's starting the Archaeological Society of India, with the other hand he's building those buildings, those great Indo-Saracenic buildings. The term Indo-Saracenic man, he could only live in India. Where else in the world are Muslims of the Middle East called Saracens anymore? It's like if you were in America, you talked about, Caucasian nigger architecture. You wouldn't. You so wouldn't. But in India, people, architecture professors will say, we are now facing the Indo-Saracenic building. We need to think of a new way of looking at these buildings, a new term for these buildings. In 1992, that mosque falls. In 1992, Bombay burns. There are riots. The myth begins to corrode. We are not a cosmopolitan city. We are a dangerous city that hates each other, and we are living on the edge of violence because the amount that is available, Bombay is slowly running out of steam. It's so slow, it's so imperceptible, no one has noticed it, but it's slowly running out of steam. No new investment has happened in Bombay in the last 10 years. Investment is, and in the last 10 years, you've had huge inputs of money into India because suddenly we are the Asian tiger, we are tomorrow's economy, India and China will boom, blah, 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 blah. It's being talked about all over the world. Billions of dollars are coming into India, they're not coming to Bombay. Intellectual, Indian intellectual, age 43, I'm pink, I'm a socialist, right? Everybody's a socialist, all my friends are socialists. If they're not socialists, I shoot them. But even I know that a city that is not attracting investment is a city that is beginning to die. The city is beginning to die around us because we are not attracting investment. If the history of cities used to be written in terms of architecture, the history of cities used to be written in terms of political stances and positions, today the history of cities can only be written in terms of economics. Because a city is a magnificent, huge magnet for money. It has to be a magnet for money because it spends a huge amount of money. Right? Imagine there are 13 million people. You know, add a few million and you have the whole of Australia living in this little inch of land. How do you give them all toilets? What is the Indian solution? You don't give them. There is one toilet for every 39 people in this city. This means that if you want to take a dump in a toilet, you have to wait an average of 1.2 weeks. That's a long time. So you get a dump on the road. I have a t-shirt with a crow on it that says, I love India. The crow loves India not for any other reason, but because there's a lot of shit in the roads. This is approximately where we are today. Questions? No questions, thank you all so much. Okay, bits and pieces of Bombay's history. One of the things that everyone forgets is that this entire nation is built on opium. 33 1/3% of the Raj's income was opium. They grew it in India. The Parsis, which is a small community, but a very powerful community that came in from Iran, escaping Muslim persecution. They came in from Iran. They were the middlemen. They built the ships. The name Wadia is a shipbuilding name. It means shipbuilder. They built the ships and the opium went out to Bombay or went out to Calcutta and went up to China and was force-fed into the Chinese, so that poor Chinese Empress Yuxi said to herself, now we will not have we will not have opium forced onto us. So what did she do? She got a whole bunch of young men together and trained them in boxing. Now, if you think about it, the British have guns. You're training people to box. What is the contest here? What is the logic here? Why don't we just go out and buy some guns from someone who doesn't like it? No, you train everyone to box. Right? So this, all the Chinese are coming out to box and the British shoot them through the neck. And quell the Boxer Rebellion and say, you will take opium nicely. And lie down there quietly because you are degenerate patients. Sheep, we have to rule you because otherwise look by what you'll do. You'll take drugs and die. So the result is almost all the big, you know, there's that great saying that there is no great fortune but there is a great crime behind it. The great, if you look around this city, there is Parsi philanthropy. Remember I told you there is no tradition, but the Parsis have a great tradition of philanthropy. They built practically everything. They built the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, the Tata this, the Tata that, the Tata. The Jaya, this building is one of those gifts of the Tatas to the city of Bombay. Right? This is the Sir Jamshedji Jiji boy, who is a Parsi. He gave the land, he gave the money for the building. He said, nice, let us have a college of art, let us have a college of architecture, etc. He gave the money. But this money comes out of gift. It's money that was made in slave trading and in drug money. So Bombay is built on slave on drug money. Now why do you think we produce Bollywood? Which is a drug. Yeah, it's not supposed to make you think. It's not supposed to give you great ideas about the future, because there are some stupid filmmakers now who are trying to make films about important issues. We don't want important issues. For important issues, we will have other people. They will make boring, dirty films where people don't talk for hours and hours, and you know, and non-actors who are not even good looking will be put on stage in murals, all Jessica or sad faces. We want good looking boys, good looking girls. Let's dance! We want happiness! We want 3 hours of Elizabethan entertainment that incorporates everything. We want tragedy, we want joy, we want sorrow, and we want moral lessons as well. Treat your mommy and daddy nicely. Anyone who's crying in a film, in a Hindi film, will be very happy. And the people who are happy, you know, they will be very sad. This is the model. It's a lovely model, it makes you feel so happy. That's how Bollywood runs. Bollywood runs on the notion that if you live in a state of perpetual emergency. I mean, Bombay is a state of perpetual emergency. Anything could happen at any moment. Yeah? I mean, you get up in the morning and the water doesn't come out of your taps. If this happened in a European city, you'd write to your council, you'd sue this, you'd talk to that, the paper. If water doesn't come out of your taps, you go to the phone, you call up a tanker, the tanker comes, fills your water, you pay for water. You pay much, much more for that, but you pay. Because the tanker has a lobby. The tankers have a lobby. They can grow, every time a water pipe, new water pipe is put up, they break the water. So that you will continue to get your water by tanker and they will get rich. It's very simple. Put up a new business, they break it. I think it's a great system because all you have to do is have access to one source of water. If you have one spring on your property, you can fill 400 tanks a day. If you fill 400 tanks a day, it means 160,000 rupees is on the road a day. And all the cost that you have is the cost of the diesel that goes in. Then you naturally you break the pipes. There was this and of course the only in Indian elections will the tanker lobby stand against the criminal drug lobby. And the drug lobby's promises, I will give you water to his constituents. So the constituents who, you know, in any other city would say, I mean, giving us water, he says, I will give you water, I will die. Okay, so they elect him and the result is that the water lobby goes to the government and pays a huge amount of money so that the crime, so a couple of people actually stand up and say he murdered my uncle, he murdered my auntie, so the chap from the crime lobby is thrown into jail. So he can't build anything and everyone's happy. And he has a mobile phone in jail so he can run his drug operations from jail. So all is happy. This sounds familiar, right? Italy only. Only we don't have a Berlusconi to keep us happy and a minister. We have very sada, very quiet prime minister, does not have a fancy girlfriend. Come on. Okay, questions.
I even
asked
when we continue.
Yeah, I know, I'll keep on
talking.
Yeah, when can we find your books?
Oh,
Do you have
all major bookshops. And the internet is a good thing, just whatever, Google Jelly Pinto and my books turn up on the internet, etc. They're not half as much fun as I am. yeah, anything else? Any other questions, however, off the board?
Yes, the future.
Oh, there isn't. I mean, you know, logically, there isn't supposed to be a future for Bombay. Bombay is supposed to have died long ago. Our particulates, I mean, there's a hospital, a cancer hospital. The India's biggest cancer hospital is in Bombay, not unsurprisingly. Now this cancer hospital is the Tata Cancer Hospital. So again, it was drug money that started. But outside the Tata Memorial, there are people who sit on the road and wait for their next chemotherapy. So there's a whole entire village of people who live on the road with chemotherapy, who are undergoing chemotherapy. Many of them have masks on. Their immunity is really low. When you take chemotherapy, there is a time when immunity is really low. They sit on the road because they can't go home. Chemotherapy will take 6 months, right? Or 3 months, or 4 months. You can't go home and come back every week because your home is 40 hours by train away. So you sit on the road and you wait. And then what happens is that an industry is built up around, not an industry, but a whole philanthropic organization comes into existence for these people. So local, all the local shopkeepers will give them discounts if they present their cards. So you have to present your card saying, I am a cancer patient. You present it and you get a discount. Someone comes every morning, another bunch of shopkeepers come every morning and give them breakfast. Another bunch comes every evening and gives them dinner. People come with water. People come with this. People come with that. And look after them on the road. And the rate of recovery is astounding. It is 70%. Despite the fact that you're sitting on the road just after your chemotherapy, you're vomiting persistently, and drug and fuel exhaust from cars is being pumped into your face, you recover. That defies all science. That is Bombay food.
Is that a symbol for solidarity?
It's a wonderful thing. Many of the stories I think that one can tell about Bombay are beautiful stories. Just when I discovered that this lovely little school called Holy Mother, it is It is founded on the principle that many children cannot come to school in Bombay because they are paralyzed with polio. Oh, the polio story is another great story. At one point, the World Health Organization decided, no more polio, no more polio, we shall overcome, kill polio, right? What they forgot was that the polio vaccine requires a cold chain. Right up to the delivery where we keep the polio vaccine in refrigeration. You can't do this in India. Refrigeration, right? But then also rumors were spread around the Muslims that the polio vaccine was supposed to make children infertile, so they wouldn't have children. So they stopped taking the polio vaccine. The result is lots of Muslim children who are anyway at the lowest, I mean one of the many studies, the Sakhir Committee report, etc., have pointed out that Muslims in India are really underserved. This is because of stupid America. Why is it stupid America? Because they support the bloody Wahhabis in Saudi Arabia. So the Wahhabis will send you money, in Zakat they will send you, but only for schools in Arabic. Right, in India Arabic is going to help a lot, right? I mean a Muslim kid who reads Arabic is going to get a job in a call center tomorrow, right? So Holy Mother English is a simple idea. If you have a paralyzed child at home, he will come, a volunteer will come, pick her up and bring her to school. And the volunteer will go back in the evening, pick her up and carry her home. And the children are going through school, they are getting a schooling. It's a lovely story. Every time I think about it, I feel like it. Okay? But why do we need it? Why do we need volunteers? We have money. Rahul Gandhi has said that 5 paise in every 100 paise in poverty alleviation schemes goes to the poor. 5 paise out of 95% goes to the middleman because, okay, you're poor, right? You're terribly poor and I announce a scheme for you. Take, here's some government money. What do? You go into your local government office and you say, there is one scheme for me, no, please give me some money. They say, yeah, but you have to fill out these many forms. Okay, 500 forms. You have to submit these many documents. You have to do this. And that poor person sits there thinking, what? So the person in the desk says, but I can help you. Go to him, he'll help you. That him there will take 50% of it. Someone else will take 20% of it. Someone else will take 10% of it. Someone who has to give you this paper will take 10% of it. Eventually you'll get 5 rupees out of 100 rupees that he was supposed to give. So there is money for poverty alleviation. Last year, 1,000 crores of the education budget was unused. Unused. Okay. Why does that have to happen? So, great stories, you know, stories of people helping, stories of people managing, always make you feel good, but they don't have to manage. It's the government's job to manage this stuff. My job is just to get on with my life and have a living. And my job is to be able to go and have a nice expensive meal if I want, without incurring social guilt all the time, thinking, you know, with this money, 800 children could be fed. But I incur that guilt every time. You think it's fun living in India? Yeah. Give me your passport and take money.
You mentioned how the Mumbais see themselves. How does the rest of India see the Mumbais?
See, it's my belief that everyone in India has a dream to become a Mumbai. They want to come and become Bombay people. Okay? And then they try in their small ways to be Bombay people wherever they are. But consider this, according to me, there are 3 reasons for a big city. 3 indices for a big city. One, you must have big buildings. The second, you must have minorities. And the third is a woman should be able to get a cup of coffee at 2 o'clock in the morning. These are the 3 things that make a big city. Okay? Bombay has big buildings, it has minorities. Women can't have a cup of coffee at 2 a.m. in the morning, but they are safest in Bombay. They are safer than anywhere in the city. I teach a journalism at a class in Bombay, and we draw in students from all over the country. All the girls from every other part of the country cannot believe the freedom that they have in Bombay. The freedom to take a taxi in the night. In Delhi, if you take a taxi in the night, you better be with 2 of your brothers. One sits in front, one sits behind. Because the taxi driver might drive you away and sell you into sex slavery. Rape you, murder you, these are the smaller things he could do. Yeah. So I think Bombay actually has is the only city that has the indices of urbanity. Goa is developing an odd kind of urbanity of its own. I think, you know, if you talk to Rahul about that on his own, you'll find that's another kind. But it's a small village, big city, tension urbanity. This, you know, village, we are city. Bombay people always talk about going to their native place, going home to their native place. It's kind of like, you know, you go back to your native place. You're very clearly an outsider now. You are marked by who you are. You are expected to take gifts from the city. The same, you know, sort of multinational corporations are saying Goa, but I am expected to take gifts from Bombay, as if I had come from abroad. Still. You know? So it is considered a different kind of experience. Will that answer your question?
Yeah,
okay. Great, thank you so much.